So the topic is orientation to theory, ancient times and modern times. So I have divided my lecture, my presentation into two halves. In the first part of the lecture, I'll be talking about classical theory. And in the second half of my presentation, I'll be talking about modern theory. I will touch upon six important facets, six important dimensions of modern theory. Okay, so I think I have been asked to speak for 75 minutes. So by 12:45, I'll wind up and maybe we will have some 15 minutes for some questions and for some discussions. Okay, can I ask the first question? Okay, maybe I'll ask you. Okay, not necessary this particular lady. A very easy question, a very simple question. I am sure all of you will be able to answer. I am sure you have a personal copy of this book. Who is the author of A Glossary of Literary Terms? Okay, very good. M.H. Abrams. Anything more about M.H. Abrams? What is his nationality? And what are the other books written by M.H. Abrams? Okay, I'll answer the first question and you please answer the second question. Okay, he is an American. Okay, and something very significant about his life. He died only in 2015. Now we are in 2020, the early part of 2020. M.H. Abrams died only in 2015. Imagine, at the age of 103. Okay, that is about his personal life. Now my second question, Glossary of Literary Terms, that was written by M.H. Abrams. Now what are the other books written by M.H. Abrams? Beg your pardon? Okay, so an article called Deconstructive Angel. Now because he was a fierce critic of Derrida and deconstruction. Okay, so he has written an article. As a liberal humanist, he was against Derrida, he was against deconstruction. So this was in a PMLA seminar. He presented this paper called The Deconstructive Angel. Very good. Any book by M.H. Abrams? Okay, so ma'am has given the answer. There is a very important book with the title The Mirror and the Lamp. I'm sure you have heard about this book. Okay, The Mirror and the Lamp. Ma'am, can you please tell us in which year it was published? Okay, it was published in 1953. Okay, so all of you please take a note of it. In 1953, M.H. Abrams had published a book with the title The Mirror and the Lamp. This was on Romanticism and on Romantic Poetry. I'll be talking about this book, but I will come back to this book a little later. Now, what are the other books written by M.H. Abrams? Oh, you're tempted to Google? Okay, he has a very famous book with the title Naturalism and Supernaturalism. One more book, How to Do Things with Text. Okay? But the American academic community, particularly the departments of English, they remember M.H. Abrams for another significant contribution. Is there any famous anthology that you can remember? Any famous anthology? Any famous anthology? Anthology of British literature, anthology of American literature, anthology of criticism? The Norton, N-O-R-T-O-N. Okay, it was M.H. Abrams who edited and brought out the first Norton anthology of English literature. And the American academic community remembers M.H. Abrams. Because in American universities, this is the standard book, okay? Just as you carry textbooks, the American students of English, they carry this Norton anthology of English literature. So it was M.H. Abrams who edited and brought out the Norton anthology of English literature. So much about M.H. Abrams. Now, ma'am gave the correct answer. In 1953, M.H. Abrams brought out a book with the title the mirror and the lamp. Please look at the title. It has two significant metaphors. I'll be talking about these two metaphors a little later. Okay, fine. Now, if you open this book, the first chapter is supposed to be a very important chapter. The first chapter is supposed to be a significant chapter. I'm sure some of you are familiar with this. It is titled Orientation to Critical Theories. Okay, so I have borrowed this title for my lecture today. Okay, so the book is The Mirror and the Lamp. The opening chapter or the introductory chapter is titled Orientation of Critical Theories. Okay, so for the next 30-35 minutes, I'll be talking about this chapter. I'll be drawing insights, I'll be drawing inspiration from M.H. Abrams. Okay, so the book is The Mirror and the Lamp. The first chapter is Orientation of Critical Theories, and this chapter is divided into two parts. In the first part, he talks about the basis or the foundation of literary criticism, and this he does by talking about four coordinates. If you are not very comfortable with the term coordinates, you can substitute it, you can replace it with the term pillars. The basis or the foundation or the anchorage of literary criticism. So if you can imagine, if you can visualize literary criticism as a house or as a building, it rests on four coordinates, four pillars, and this is what he talks about in the first part of the chapter, Orientation of Critical Theories. So naturally, what is the question? What are these four pillars? What are these four coordinates? Okay, so the four pillars or the four coordinates are, the first coordinate is the universe, also known as life, also known as reality. So that would be the first coordinate. The second coordinate is the literary text, the poem, the novel, the drama, the short story. So that would be the second coordinate. The third one is the author, the writer. And the fourth one is the reader or the audience. Now what M.H. Abrams does is, he presents or talks about these four coordinates or four pillars in the form of a diagrammatic or a schematic representation. Okay? Now imagine a triangle, visualize a triangle. So at the top of the triangle, at the apex, at the top, you have the universe. Then you come to the bottom. On one side you have the author or the writer, and on the other side you have the reader or the audience. Okay, so you visualize the triangle. Right on top you have universe, also known as life, also known as reality. Then when you come to the bottom, on one side you have the author or the writer or the creator, and on the other side you have the reader or the audience. Now at the heart of the triangle you have the text. Okay, so this is what he does in the first part of the introductory chapter. He talks about the four coordinates: the universe, the text, the author, and the reader. Fine. Now the second part of the chapter is significant because it is in the second chapter that he talks about four literary theories that correspond to or that are correlated with the four coordinates that he talks about in the first part of the chapter. So in the first part of the chapter, he talks about the four coordinates, namely the universe, the text, the author, and the reader. So in the second part, which is much more important than the first part of the chapter, he talks about four literary theories that are closely or intimately connected to or connected with the four coordinates. So the first one is universe, and the literary theory that corresponds to the coordinate called universe is the mimetic theory. Okay, so universe and closely associated with the universe is the mimetic theory. So what is mimetic theory? Who propounded it? I'll be talking about it a little later. Okay, so universe and correlated with the universe, you have the mimetic theory. Now, right at the heart of the triangular structure, you have the text, the poem, the novel, the drama, the short story, and associated with the text, you have the formalist theory. So the mimetic theory, that is associated with the universe. Formalist theory, later I'll be talking about the two kinds of formalism, the Anglo-American formalism and the Russian formalism, very briefly. So we have the formalist theory, and that is to be connected to, that is to be correlated with the text. Okay, now what are the two coordinates left out? We have the author, and connected to the author we have the expressive theory. And connected to the reader or the audience you have the pragmatic theory. So what are the four theories? Mimetic theory, formalistic theory, expressive theory and pragmatic theory. Okay, so I'll just summarize. So in 1953, M.H. Abrams brought out a book with the title The Mirror and the Lamp. So this was a book on romanticism and romantic poetry. So the opening chapter of this book is titled Introduction, Orientation to Critical Theories. And this chapter is divided into two parts, not equal parts, because the second part of the chapter consumes many more pages than the first part of the chapter. So in the first part, he talks about the four coordinates, namely the universe, the text, the author, and the reader. And in the remaining part of the chapter, he talks about four literary theories that correspond to or that are related to the four coordinates, namely the mimetic theory, the formalistic theory, the expressive theory, and the pragmatic theory. Fine. Now let me very briefly talk about each of the four theories. Fine. So the first one is mimetic theory. Okay, so mimetic theory comes from mimesis. M-I-M-E-S-I-S, mimesis. Now, you proposed a good vote of thanks. Yes. Mimesis, what is the origin of this word, the etymology? What language? Greek, you're not very sure? Okay, so Greek, your Jos. Rose, okay. So Rose says the word mimesis, M-I-M-E-S-S, is a Greek word, and what does it mean? Imitation. Okay, now go back to the title of the book by M.H. Abrams. What is the title? The Mirror and the Lamp. I said it harps on two metaphors, two significant metaphors, the mirror and the lamp. Okay, fine. So mimesis, M-I-M-E-S-A-S, is a Greek word which means imitation, reflection, a mirror. Now how do we define literature? Okay, go back to your first year BA. I am sure your first few classes, your professors must have told you what is literature, how do you define literature. Okay, literature is a mirror of life, literature is a reflection of life, literature is an imitation of life. Okay, imitation. So the mirror and the lamp, like a mirror, it reflects life, it represents life, it recreates life, it refashions life, it reformulates life. That is literature, and this is the mimetic theory. Okay, so very briefly. So mimesis is a Greek word which means imitation, and it talks of art as an imitation of life, as an imitation of universe, as an imitation of reality. Fine. Now the next question, who propounded the mimetic theory of art? Aristotle, okay, correct answer. Can you better the answer? I'll give you 7 out of 10. So remaining 3 marks. The question is, who propounded, who initially talked about art as representation, art as mimesis? It was Plato. Okay, what is the connection between Plato and Aristotle? Okay, Plato was Aristotle's teacher. Okay, because Plato had established an academy, okay, the modern day college or the modern day university, and Aristotle was a student in Plato's academy. But once Plato died, Aristotle left the academy, and then he became a wanderer, and then later he went to Macedonia, and then he tutored Alexander the Great. So what is the lineage? We start with Socrates. Socrates was the guru and his shishya was Plato. So Plato was the guru and his shishya was Aristotle, and Aristotle became the teacher later, and his disciple was Alexander the Great. Fine. Now, what did Plato write? What did Plato write? How many books did he write, Plato? Okay, did Socrates write anything? What is the famous book by Socrates? Very often in philosophy, we talk about Socrates, we refer to Socrates, we invoke the name of Socrates. So what is the book by Socrates? Okay, Socrates did not write anything. He did not produce any book, he did not author any book, but he is the principal character, he is the main character, he is the chief character in Plato's dialogues. Okay, so what is the book written by Plato? Dialogues. There are more than 100 dialogues. More than 100 dialogues. For us students of literature, the most important dialogue is? I said there are hundreds of dialogues. We are all students of literature, students of art. So which is the most important dialogue for us, for students of literature, for students of art? Republic. Okay, Republic. Now, what is the meaning of a dialogue? Okay, the Americans are fond of the word conversation. Okay, they are not very fond of the word dialogue. Okay, if you listen to Trump or Obama and others, they frequently use the word conversation. Anyway, let us stick to the word dialogue. So, what is the dialogue? Okay, a conversation between two people. Okay, so who are the two people who are involved in the conversations that we find in Plato? Is my question clear? So what Plato wrote is called dialogues, and there are hundreds of dialogues. The most important dialogue for students of literature is Republic. Okay, so Republic is a dialogue. It is a conversation between two people. As is the case with the other dialogues of Plato. Now, who are the two people who are involved in a discussion in Republic and in other dialogues? At least one you know for sure. Socrates. Okay, so Socrates is the principal character in Plato's dialogues. So who is the other? Who is the other? Okay, a young person like you. A young Athenian, Athens, okay, so Greece, Athens, okay, so people of Kochi are called Kochiites or Kochians, whatever it is, so Athenian, okay, a youngster or the youth of Athens, fine. Now, what was the question? What is the question that we are trying to address, we are trying to answer? Who first talked about art as mimesis? It was Plato. It was Plato in his Republic. It was Plato in Republic. He talked about art as mimesis. Now later, Aristotle also talked about art as imitation. But then if you ask me, is there any difference between what Aristotle said and what Plato said regarding the conception of art as imitation? Okay, there is a minor difference. Okay, so what is this difference? Both Plato and Aristotle had argued, what is art? Art is a representation of life. Art is a mirror of life. Art is a reformulation of life. Art is a representation of life. So both of them talked about the mimetic theory of art. But then there is a subtle difference between what Plato said on the one hand and what Aristotle said on the other. Now, as far as Plato is concerned, art has to be a slavish or a servile imitation. Okay? Imagine he is an artist. Okay, so we give him this chair and we ask him to reproduce this chair. Okay? So according to Plato, what should he do? He has to produce an exact copy, a replica. Whereas Aristotle would say, you imitate, all right. But then use your originality, use your imagination, use your creativity. Okay? If he is Plato, he will not change the color. Okay, whereas Aristotle would say, okay, you reproduce this chair, maybe you can change the color, maybe you can change the shape. So this was the subtle distinction between Plato on the one hand and Aristotle on the other, as far as their theory of imitation was concerned. So both of them had argued that art was mimesis, art was representation. But the way they understood art as mimesis or representation was a little different, because in the eyes of Plato, art is imitation, but it has to be exact. It has to be a servile or a slavish imitation, whereas Aristotle said you imitate, but then you can make it a little original. Now there is a key idea here. What is the key idea? According to Plato, art is imitation, but a poor imitation. What did I say? According to Plato, what is art? Art is imitation of life, a mirror of life, mimesis. But it is a poor imitation. What are the exact words of Plato? Twice removed from reality. Not once, but twice removed from reality. Now, what exactly did he mean by this? Okay, imagine I borrow a book from Francis. Okay? And I make a Xerox copy. Okay? I take it back to my department. Okay, one of my colleagues likes the book and he said, can I borrow your book? I say, yes. What does he do? He takes the book and makes another Xerox copy. So, which means Francis has the original. I have the first photocopy and my colleague has the second photocopy. So, what I have, the first photocopy or the first Xerox copy, is once removed from reality, and my colleague has made another photocopy from the photocopy that I have made out of the original. So, that would be twice removed from reality. In other words, according to Platonic metaphysics and epistemology, I mean, don't ask me further questions, okay? So this is what Plato had said. This is not the real world. This is not a real chair. This is not the real fan. Okay, so everything that we have, the prototype or the original exists somewhere else, which is governed by a demiurge. That is the real world, a resplendent world which is governed, which is administered by a demiurge, a godlike figure. And this world is only an imitation of that world, which is the real world or the actual world. So as poets, as artists, as photographers, when we reproduce this real world, we are only imitating what is already an imitation. Okay, so this is clear? So there are two ideas. Okay, so the first coordinate is the universe, also known as life, also known as reality. And the literary theory that corresponds to the first coordinate is the mimetic theory, which talks about art as representation or art as mirror of life. And it was Plato in his Republic who first talked about the theory of art as imitation. And he said art is an imitation of an imitation. Twice removed from reality. Fine. So this is the first theory. Now let us come to the second theory, formalist theory. Now look at the word formalist. What does it mean? We have two schools here. We have two types of formalism. On the one hand, we have Russian formalism, and on the other, we have British and American formalism, and British and American put together, it is called Anglo-American formalism. So the word Anglo-American would refer to the British variety, the British school, and the American school or the American variety. Instead of saying the British and the American, we prefer to use the term, the hyphenated term, Anglo-American. So we have two schools of formalism, namely we have the Russian variety and we have the Anglo-American variety. Now the Anglo-American variety is also known as New Criticism, N-E-W, New Criticism with a capital N. Now the basic question that we have to raise is, what exactly is formalism? Now if you are reading a short story, Would you pay attention to the story part of it, the content part of it, or would you pay attention to the language or the structure, the metaphors, the simile, the various literary devices? Is my question clear? If you're reading a novel or a drama or an essay or a poem, or if you're watching a film, would you focus on the story part of it, the content, the theme or the subject matter? This is on the one side. Or the way the story has been told, the way the story has been narrated. So would you focus on the form or the structure or the stylistic devices? What would you focus on? I'm sure my question is clear. Is it the content which will draw your attention, or is it the form that will call for your attention? Okay, that depends on the literary work. Okay, fine. But I'm sure the answer is clear now. Okay, so what is formalism? So formalism is a school, a critical school, which focuses more on the form and less on the content. Okay, as students of literature, we know that both are important. The story is important, and equally important is the way the story is narrated. So the narrative part of it, that is also equally important. What if I have prepared well, but then my delivery is very poor? Okay, or I have nothing, but my presentation is great. Okay, so you will say, oh, he spoke well, but there was nothing. Okay, so both are equally important. The story is important, and equally important is the form. Okay, fine. Now, traditionally what happened was, there was an undue emphasis and undue attention on the content part of it. So much so, the form, the structure, the narrative devices, the language, that was neglected. Okay, so formalism in a sense was reactionary, because the formalists, not that they did not want to focus on the content, not that they neglected content. Content, they recognized the importance of content, but then if you have to make a choice, okay, A or B, content or form, theme or structure, so they would say, we are more interested in the form, we are more interested in the structure, we are more interested in the narrative part of it than in the content. And because they focused attention on form, they were called the formalists. Okay? So there were two types of formalism, two schools of formalism. We had the Russian variety, and spearheading the Russian variety, you have Roman Jakobson, you have Eisenbaum, you have Shklovsky, you have Tomaszewski. Okay, so the most important man is Jakobson, Roman Jakobson. Okay, the spelling is J-A-K-O-B-S-O-N, but it is pronounced Jakobson. Okay, so this was the Russian school, and it developed independently of the Anglo-American school. So, okay, so both were around the same time. Not that school A copied from B, or not that B copied from A. They developed independently. I mean, those days they did not have internet and SMS and WhatsApp. Okay, so they could not communicate what each one was talking about. So these two schools developed almost independently. Fine. When you go to the Anglo-American formalism, also known as the New Criticism, who are the important people associated with the Anglo-American school of formalism known as the New Criticism? Can you please give me a few names? And who was called the high priest, the most important name, the big name in Anglo-American formalism, otherwise known as New Criticism? Okay, it is Client Brooks. Okay, I'm sure you knew the answer. B-R-O-O-K-S, Brooks. Okay, Client Brooks. He is considered the most important figure in Anglo-American formalism, also known as New Criticism. The title that was given to Client Brooks is the High Priest of New Criticism. And what is the most important book as far as new criticism is concerned? Okay, there are plenty of books. Okay, but the most important book, I'm sure you're familiar with the title, The Well-Wrought Urn. The Well-Wrought Urn. The title is borrowed from? The title is borrowed from The Well-Wrought Urn. The title is borrowed from John Donne. John Donne, which poem of John Donne? Okay, what are the poems of John Donne that you are familiar with? Canonization? Okay, so, okay, valediction, forbidding, mourning, fine. Okay, so please read Canonization. So, the title of the book by Clayne Brooks, it is a collection of essays, 19 essays. Okay, and the last essay is supposed to be a very important essay called The Heresy of Paraphrase. Okay, fine. Now, let me summarize. So, the second coordinate is the text, the novel, the poem, the drama, the short story, and associated with the text we have the formalistic theory. And when we talk of formalism, we realize that we have two schools of formalism, namely the Russian school and the Anglo-American school. They developed independently but along similar lines. There was a lot of convergence as far as these two schools were concerned. But these two schools developed independently. They did not copy or imitate or borrow or steal or copy on paste or cut and paste. Okay, they developed independently but along similar lines. The focus was on the form and not so much on the content. Fine. Now, here is an important question, and this question will answer or address or underline the importance of formalism as a school. Now, why this focus on form? Something must have inspired them to focus on form. Something must have motivated them to focus on form. Something must have goaded them, pushed them towards the focus on form. Okay, what was this? In other words, formalism or new criticism was a reaction or an opposition to biographical criticism or background criticism. Have I made it very clear? If I give a poem to you, what do I expect you to do? Read the poem, enjoy the poem, appreciate the poem, and produce, let us say, a commentary or an analysis or a critical appraisal of the poem. Yes or no? Do you agree with me? If I give a poem to you, a poem by an Indian poet or a Latin American poet like Pablo Neruda, or a Shakespearean sonnet, or a Wordsworthian ode. So what do I expect from you? I expect that you will read the poem, enjoy it, appreciate it, and maybe come out with some critical comments, one or two critical comments. But what do? You put it in your file, and then you say, let me read the poem later. Now I am interested in the author. Tell me, was the author a man or a woman? If a man, was he a queer? Was he an Naxalite? Was he an urban Naxal? Was he this? Was he that? So you want to know more about the background details. I am not saying this is not important. Okay? But what is primary and what is secondary? What is primary is the text. The author is important and the biography of the author is important only to the extent that it helps you to understand the poem in a better way. Have I made myself clear? The biography of the author is important. Without knowing that Milton was a visually challenged poet, you cannot understand Milton's sonnets because there is so much of autobiography in his sonnets. Okay, if you want to read Shelley, without knowing that Shelley was an atheist, or if you want to know Wordsworth, that he was inspired by the French Revolution, or if you want to know Wilfred Owen, he was a staunch critic of war. So without knowing the biographical aspects, you cannot appreciate their poetry. Okay? So biography is important, but only to the extent that it helps you in understanding the text. Okay? So what happened was, the biography was foregrounded, F-O-R-E, that was considered primary, and the poem, the text itself was pushed to the background, it was backgrounded. You understand this argument? So what should have been primary, what should have been in the forefront, what should have been the focus, that was pushed aside. What should have been in the background, namely the biography, the biographical details, they should have been in the background. Because I made it very clear, the biography is important only to the extent that it helps you to understand the text in a better way. Okay, so what happened was, the biography, that was pushed to the forefront. So this formalism was a reactionary movement. Okay, so I have completed two theories. I talked about the mimetic theory of art, which talks about art as representation. And I have also talked about the formalistic theory of art, which says, given a choice between content and form, we would like to choose form without, of course, totally neglecting the content part of it. Okay, fine. Next, we go to the expressive theory. Now, the expressive theory came into prominence during the 18th and the 19th century. Now, why do I say it became prominent during the 18th and 19th century? The reason is important. That was the time we have the birth of modern psychology. So, who is the father of modern psychology? Father of modern psychology. I'm sure all of you know the answer. Okay, Sigmund Freud. Okay, his book, The Interpretation of Dreams. When was it published? Okay, 1900. Okay, so that is why I said the expressive theory of criticism that became prominent during the 18th and the 19th century, because it coincides with the birth of, with the advent of modern psychology. Okay, fine. I'm sure you have Wordsworth's essay prescribed for you. Wordsworth wrote only one essay. Okay, he is primarily a poet, okay, but he is also a critic. But then he has written only one critical essay. What is that? What is the essay written by Wordsworth? Preface. Preface to lyrical ballads. What is the meaning of preface? Okay, preamble or introduction. What is lyrical ballads? What is lyrical ballads? Okay, a collection or an anthology of poems written jointly by Wordsworth and Coleridge. Most of the poems were by Wordsworth and some of the poems were by Coleridge. So it was a joint endeavor, it was a joint publication. So the anthology was called Lyrical Ballads, poems by Wordsworth and poems by Coleridge, Lyrical Ballads. Then the duo, Wordsworth and Coleridge, they decided that they should write a preface or an introduction, and that is Preface to Lyrical Ballads. I'm sure you have it prescribed for you. Okay, there is one important section where Wordsworth raises a very important question. He asks, who is a poet? What is a poet? Do you remember that paragraph?
Yes.
Okay, so the crucial question is a poet very different from other human beings? Now you answer. Is a poet, is a novelist, is a playwright, is a filmmaker, is a musician, different, very different from, strikingly different from his or her fellow human beings? Okay, we have multiple answers. Okay, granted, we have multiple answers. Some would argue, yes, they are different. Yes, they are different. Okay, God has blessed them with a lot of imagination, a lot of creativity, okay, a lot of originality. So some would argue that poets are born, not made. Okay, so they are a different species altogether. Okay, so this is one argument. What is the argument of Wordsworth? You don't remember the argument of Wordsworth. What is the question? Are poets very different from other human beings? Wordsworth says, no, they are not very different. They are different, but they are not very different. Okay? Do you have imagination? Do we have imagination? Yes, all human beings have imagination, but a poet has more than what normal individuals possess. Do you have a sense of perception, a keen sense of observation? Yes, all human beings have the sense of perception, observation. Now, a poet has it in abundance. In other words, what Wordsworth would tell us is, whatever qualities we have, whether it is originality or a sense of observation or a sense of perception, all these we have, but the poet has in abundance. Imagine I have originality 27.5%. A poet will have 74.93%. So that would be the difference. Okay, in other words, the difference is only in degree and not in kind. I'm sure you understand this expression. A difference in degree and not in kind. In other words, during the 19th century, out of curiosity regarding the working of the creative mind, I repeat, during the 19th century, particularly after the birth of modern psychology, people wanted to know how the minds of creative people work. What is it that distinguishes creative artists from other normal human beings? What is it that they possess and we do not possess? So this was the expressive theory. In other words, to put it in one sentence, now you go back to the title of the book by M.H. Abrams. There are two metaphors. The first metaphor is the mirror, and that is the mimetic theory, which talks about art as imitation. The second metaphor is the lamp. Imagine the house is dark, there is no electricity. So what happens when you light a candle or when you light a lamp? What happens? It throws light, it sheds light, it illuminates. So that is the metaphor of the lamp. In other words, the expressive theory, using the metaphor of the lamp, wants to shed light, wants to throw light on how the mind of the creative artist works and how it is different, if at all it is different, how it is different from the way our minds work. So this is the expressive theory. Clear? So I have talked about the mimetic theory, I have talked about the formalistic theory, and I have also talked about the expressive theory. So what is left? Pragmatic theory. Okay, so pragmatic theory, if I can put it in one line, the impact of art, the effect of art, the consequences of art or the ramifications of art on the reader, on the audience, it is pragmatic criticism. Okay, when you watch a drama, what happens to you? In particular, when you watch a tragedy, whether it is a Greek tragedy, a Sophoclean tragedy, or a Shakespearean tragedy, what happens to you? What are the emotions that you have to grapple with? And what happens to you at the end of the play? So this is pragmatic theory. So to put it in one sentence, the effect or the impact of art, particularly drama, very specially tragedy, on the reader or the audience. Okay? So we have two questions. So the first question is, who initiated discussion on the pragmatic theory of criticism, and who are the other proponents, and does it continue even today? Fine. Now once again we will go back to Plato and Aristotle. It was Plato who initiated the discussion on the pragmatic theory of art. What did he say? And after him, what did Aristotle say? Okay? Even though Aristotle was Plato's student, or to put it a little differently, even though Plato was Aristotle's master, guru, their views were antithetical, opposite. Okay? Did you watch any film recently? Did you go to the theater recently? Okay, why do you go to the theater? What a silly question, eh? Why do you go to the theater? Huh? No, why do you want to watch a movie? You can go to the library instead. Okay, we go to the theater for fun, for enjoyment. Okay, so the classes are boring, teachers are killing us with assignments. Okay, we want a break. We want to go to the theater and watch a good movie because we want to have some fun. We want to have some enjoyment. We want to have some relaxation. Okay, aesthetic. Okay, so what is the answer? What is the question? What is the end of art? E-N-D. What is the end of art? This was a question that was addressed by both Plato and Aristotle. What was the goal? What was the objective of art? Okay, so Aristotle would say it is for enjoyment. It is the aesthetic dimension. Now Plato, I said they are antithetical, the exact opposite. What did he say? No, it is moralistic or didactic. What is the end of art? What is the goal of art? So according to Plato, it should be didactic, it should be moralistic, it should aim at inculcating moral values in the audience. Aristotle said, no. You don't go to the theater for moral values. If you want to have moral values, then go to the church, go to the temple, go to the mosque, not to the theater. Okay, so one emphasized the moralistic dimension or the didactic dimension, then antithetically, the other emphasized or underlined the aesthetic dimension. Okay, now if I were to ask you how many of you support Plato and how many of you support Aristotle, I'm sure all of us would support Aristotle. Anybody supporting Plato here? Anyway, fine. Now I have talked about Plato, I have talked about Aristotle. Both of them are Greek philosophers. Okay, let me very briefly talk about a Latin philosopher, Horace. He wrote a long poem called Ars Poetica, A-R-S-P-O-E-T-I-C-A. It is a poem, it is a long poem. He also addressed the same question. He also tried to answer the same question. What is the question? What is the end of art? We already have two answers. Plato has said, answering the question, what is the end of art? He has said it should be moralistic. The same question has been answered by Aristotle, and his answer was it should be aesthetic. Now, what did Horace do? He was very clever. Okay, so what did he do? He combined, he synthesized, he amalgamated the idea of Plato on the one hand and the idea of Aristotle on the other. And he said the end of art, the goal of art, the objective of art is dulce et utile. Latin, D-U-L, I think Professor Prashant will know. Dulce, D-U-L-C-E, dulce. In English we have the word dulcet, dulcet symphony. You go to Francis Thompson. Francis Thompson has a beautiful poem. What is the poem? The Hound of Heaven. Okay, so there he uses this expression, dulcet symphony. Dulcet means sweet. Dulce et. Okay, you are a research scholar. I'm sure you are a research scholar. Okay, when a book is written by more than two authors, three authors, four authors, so what is the convention that you have to use according to the MLA handbook? Okay, yet all. Okay, yet all, E-T-A-L. So yet means? Okay, yet is a Latin word, means and. Dulce yet. So dulce, sweet, yet and. Utile, utility. Useful. Okay, so what is good art? It should be pleasing, it should be enjoyable, and at the same time, it should inculcate some moral values. Okay, fine. Now the discussion continues even today. Okay, you go to Philip Sidney. Okay, he says, apology for poetry. What is good poetry? What is good art? It should teach you, it should delight you, and it should motivate you to virtuous action. Or you go to Samuel Johnson, preface to Shakespeare, he continues it, and Eliot in Religion and Literature. So the debate continues. Okay, and Catharsis, Aristotle's Catharsis is part of the pragmatic theory. Okay, fine. So dear friends, I have concluded the first part of my lecture. So let me give you a summary in three sentences. Sentence number one, In 1953, M.H. Abrams brought out a book with the title The Mirror and the Lamp, and the first chapter of the book was entitled Orientation of Critical Theories. Second sentence. In the first part of the chapter, he talks about four coordinates, namely the universe, the text, the author, and the reader. Third sentence. Corresponding to these four coordinates or pillars, he talks about four literary theories, namely universe associated with the mimetic theory, text associated with the formalistic theory, the author associated with the expressive theory, and the reader or the audience associated with the pragmatic theory. So this is the first part of my lecture. Let me go to the second part of the lecture. I'll be talking about modern theory. I'll be talking about five aspects of modern theory. Fine. Now the first two I will quickly go through it. Now many of us find modern theory difficult. Okay, so whenever I go for lectures or when I meet students, okay, their complaint is almost in one voice, almost in a chorus, their complaint is, oh, modern theory is daunting, it is baffling, it is difficult, we have to study a lot, it is abstract. Okay, so they use a lot of words. Okay, fine. Now can we look at modern theory a little differently? Instead of saying it is difficult or obscure or baffling or daunting, can we say it is challenging? I'm sure there is a difference between these two. Difficult on the one hand and challenging on the other. And maybe the research scholar Rose would like to ask, why is it challenging? Okay, fine. So the first point that I would like to highlight as far as modern theory is this. Modern theory is challenging. Yes, it is challenging. Yes, it is difficult. Yes, it is baffling. Why? Because this is my first point. It is multidisciplinary in character. I'll explain and I will substantiate my argument with a lot of examples. So what did I say? Modern theory is multidisciplinary. In other words, if you do not know linguistics, particularly Saussurean or structural linguistics, you will find it very difficult to understand modern literary theory, particularly structuralism and post-structuralism. Because structuralism came out of structural linguistics, and structural linguistics is also known as Saussurean linguistics. I will talk about it a little later. So modern literary theory is founded on linguistics, particularly the Saussurean brand or the structural brand. You should know a little bit of anthropology, because they very often talk of Claude Lévi-Strauss. And who is Claude Lévi-Strauss? He was a French structural anthropologist who spent 17 long years in the forests of Amazon. He lived with a tribe, and based on his experience, empirical experience, field work, he wrote a lot of books. And for us students of literature, the most important book is The Structural Study of Myth, where he has analyzed the Oedipus myth from a structural Saussurean point of view using the linguistic framework of Saussure. So if you want to know modern theory, you should know linguistics, you should know anthropology. Then you talk of Pierre Bourdieu, Cultural Capital, you talk of Clifford Geertz, Thick Observation. You should know a little bit of sociology. Okay, so already three subjects. This is in addition to literature and literary criticism. Okay, then you should know philosophy. Why philosophy? Derrida was a philosopher, Lyotard was a philosopher, Foucault was a philosopher. So already how many subjects? In addition to literature and literary criticism, you should be familiar with linguistics, you should be conversant with anthropology, you should be familiar with sociology, you should also have a good grounding in philosophy. So studying one subject is difficult, so studying five subjects naturally makes it challenging. Okay, so therefore the first point that we have to remember is, modern literary theory is multidisciplinary. Okay, who was Foucault? A political philosopher. Who was Lyotard? A political philosopher. Who was Claude Lévi-Strauss? A structural anthropologist. Who was Jacques Lacan? A psychoanalyst. Who was Ferdinand de Saussure, the father of modern linguistics. Okay, so the list continues. Okay, in other words, whenever we refer to modern literary theories, we omit, we leave out the adjective or epithet literary or cultural. Okay, it is called theory with a capital T. Okay, in other words, if you are referring to Marxism as a theory, if you are referring to feminism as a theory, if you are referring to structuralism as a theory, you use theory with a small t, lowercase. But when you talk of theory as such, without reference to feminism or Marxism or post-structuralism or deconstruction or postmodernism or new historicism, you use theory with a capital T. Okay, in other words, and this has been explained beautifully by Jonathan Culler, he has written a book called Literary Theory, a very short introduction, only 120 pages, you please read it. A very well written book, the title is Literary Theory, a very short introduction by Jonathan Culler. So he says, instead of calling it literary, critical, cultural, anthropological, sociological, philosophical theory, don't you think it is long winding? Yes or no? So he says it is best to call it theory with a capital T, because when you use the capital T to refer to theory, it includes, it is not only literary, it is not only cultural, but it is also linguistic, it is also sociological, it is also philosophical, it is also anthropological, and so many other things. Okay, so the first point that I want to highlight is theory, not literary theory, not critical theory, not cultural theory, not philosophical theory. Theory is multidisciplinary. Okay, so therefore, if you want to master theory, in addition to theory, in addition to literary theory, literary criticism, you should also do some work, some homework in linguistics, philosophy, anthropology, sociology, semiology. It is not very difficult. Okay, so all that you have to do is you have to do homework. So the first point that I want to highlight or underline as far as theory is concerned is theory is multidisciplinary. I said I will talk about 5 points, so 4 more points. Number 2, theory is no more the handmaiden of literature. Okay, I'm sure some of you will recognize the phrase handmaiden. Where does it come? I think I should ask the priest. I have already given a clue. When the angel appears to, when Gabriel appears to Mary, okay, so she, I think it is in Luke, the Annunciation, okay, so she says, I am the handmaiden of the Lord, okay, handmaiden, okay, almost like a slave, subservient, okay, fine. So earlier, creative writing was considered primary and criticism was considered a secondary activity. Have you made it clear? I repeat, creative writing, writing poetry, writing novels, writing dramas, writing short story, that was considered something superior, something brilliant, because you're taking up some creative work, creative activity, you're creating something, just as God is the creator, so you're creating something. So that is a primary activity. Now, you are commenting on what somebody else has written. So, that is only, you are not creating something. Somebody else has created a poem, somebody else has written a novel, somebody else has written a short story. And what are you doing? You are commenting on it, you are analyzing it, you are examining it, you are critiquing it. So, you are indulging in a secondary activity. I'm sure most of you agree, or maybe you disagree. But earlier the proposition was very clear. So what was the proposition? Poets were primary and critics were secondary. In fact, there is even a joke. Who are the critics? You try your hand at writing poetry. If you don't succeed, the next best thing that you can do is you become a critic. So critics are failed poets. I mean, this is a joke, fine. So imagine, Rose is a poet, and what is your name? Lakshmi is a critic. Okay, all of you please listen. So Rose is a poet and Lakshmi is a critic. Okay, as long as Rose is busy writing poems, Lakshmi's job is secure. Okay, imagine Rose suddenly decides to go on a vacation. She says, I'm very tired, I want to have a break, I want to go for holidays. So she goes on a vacation for 2 weeks. Now what happens to Lakshmi? Poor Lakshmi. She is without a job. Why? As a critic, she is dependent on a creative writer. See, this has been beautifully talked about by Lévi-Strauss in a different context. He uses the concept of bricolage. Okay, you study it later. Okay, particularly if you go to the essay by Genet, Structuralism and Literary Criticism, he uses the analogy. Okay, how bricolage is like a critic and how a writer is like an engineer. Bricolage, bricolage. Okay, so if later when you go back, okay, you please refer to, you Google it, bricolage. Okay, originally a term used by Lévi-Strauss. Okay, on the analogy of writer, bricolage, bricolar. Okay, fine. Anyway, now let us come back to Lakshmi. Okay, so when does Lakshmi become employed? After Rose comes back from her vacation and starts writing, once again, Lakshmi has some job on hand. Okay, now, I mean, this is only an example to highlight what is the position and what is the status of the creative artist and what is the position and what is the status of the critic. So the creative writer is primary and the job of the critic is only secondary. In other words, the handmaiden of literature. Okay, fine. Now imagine the scenario now, 2020. What will Lakshmi say? Earlier, what did Lakshmi say? If Rose writes something, I will have some job. If Rose doesn't write anything, imagine Rose one day says, I have a headache, today I am not writing anything, or I am going to my mother's place, I am on vacation. Then Lakshmi doesn't have any job. But today, what would Lakshmi say? If you write something, I will produce a commentary, or I will write a criticism, or I will critique what you have said. If you have not written something also, don't worry, don't think that I will be jobless. I can write something on my own. I can, Roland Barthes would say, I can write an essay called The Death of the Author independently. I need not be dependent on a creative writer. I am sure you understand the contrast. So earlier the position was, the creative writer was primary and the critic was secondary. Criticism was dependent on creative writing. Okay, but look at the modern scenario. The critic is no more dependent on the creative writer. Look at Roland Barthes, look at Michel Foucault, look at Derrida, look at Lyotard. They all produce independent essays. They are not subservient to creative writers. So the first proposition was, theory is multidisciplinary. The second proposition is, theory is no more subservient to literature. Theory is no more the handmaiden of literature. Theory is autonomous. It has come of age. Okay, so the critic enjoys a equal status to that of the poet, to that of the playwright, to that of the novelist. He or she is no more dependent on the creative writer, no more subservient to the creative writer. Okay, I said I will talk about 5 points, I have completed 3. We'll go to the third one. The third one is, theory has announced the death of the author. Theory has announced the death of the author. Who wrote the essay, The Death of the Author? Okay, Roland Barthes. In which year was that? In which year was that? 1960? 1967, and I am sure all of you have read this essay, the death of the author, 1967. I want you to read three essays together. In fact, 3+1, the fourth one a little later. Please not read one, but please read three essays together, then you will have a comprehensive or a holistic understanding of the concept of the death of the author. So in 1967, Roland Barthes wrote a very influential essay with the title, The Death of the Author. In 1969, 2 years after the publication of Roland Barthes' The Death of the Author, Michel Foucault wrote an essay with the title, What is an Author? And 2 years later, that was in 1971, Roland Barthes wrote another essay with the title, From Work to Text. Okay, so 67, The Death of the Author, 69, Foucault's, What is an Author, and 71, From Work to Text. Please read all the three essays together if you want to have a holistic or a comprehensive or a synoptic understanding of the idea of the death of the author. Okay. Now, what is this death of the author? What does it talk about? And we have to add a very important question. Is this an absolutely original essay? Or has this idea or concept, the death of the author, has it been already talked about or prefigured in any way? I will address this question a little later. Okay, fine. Now, I would like to focus on three important ideas. What are the three important ideas? Semantic autonomy, I'll explain. Semantic autonomy, semantic polysemy, and the birth of the reader. So, what are the three ideas? Semantic autonomy, semantic polysemy, and the birth of the reader. Fine. What's your name?
Jomi Thomas.
Okay, now Thomas, let us take Thomas as an example. Now Thomas has written a poem. What is the title? An Ode to Kochi. Imagine he has written a poem, An Ode to Kochi. Okay, yes? He has written. So Thomas has written a poem, An Ode to Kochi. Okay? And he has distributed copies of his poem. So each one of us, we have a copy of the poem written by Thomas. The title of the poem is An Ode to Kochi. You call it Kochi or Ernakulam? Okay, An Ode to Kochi. And what are we supposed to do? We are supposed to talk about his poem. We are supposed to discuss his poem. Okay? So I start the discussion. I am into the fourth sentence or fifth sentence, immediately Thomas says, no, please stop. This is not what I meant. You should read it like this. Rose wants to open her mouth and then she is about to say something, immediately Thomas says, no, you have misunderstood. So what does Thomas do? We are discussing his poem. So what does he do? He is a real nuisance. Why? Sitting there, he is instructing all of us, this is how you have to look at it, you should not look at this, look at the metaphor, you have missed the fourth line, you have missed the 18th line, look carefully at the 7th line, there is something special. So he is constantly interfering, he is a nuisance. So much so, we all get fed up with Thomas and tell him, Thomas, you shut up. We have written the poem, you shut up. No, you don't speak. Let the poem speak. So what do we tell Thomas? As the author, you are dead. The death of the author. Okay? Because you are a nuisance, you are an interference, you are constantly telling us what we should read, how we should read. You don't give us the liberty, you don't give us the freedom, you don't give us the artistic freedom or the license for us to read as readers. So you shut up. The death of the author. So what happens? Once we pronounce or declare the death of the author, the text is given semantic autonomy. The text is liberated from the author. Now the text can speak. And as readers, we can also look at the text from multiple points of view. But as long as Thomas is there, will he allow us to look at it from different points of view? No, he will not allow us to look at it from different points of view, because as the author, as the creator, as the originator, he will say, this is my poem. I should tell you, because I am the creator, I am the father, I will tell you how you should look at it. So, he is constantly interfering. So, once we pronounce him dead, once we declare him dead, then we have the freedom to look at the text in multiple ways. If he looks at the text, he will look at it from his point of view, and the poem will generate only one reading or one meaning. But when he is pronounced dead, when he is declared dead, we have the artistic freedom or the artistic license to look at the text from multiple points of view. And when we look at the text from multiple, I will look at it from my point of view, Dr. Francis will look at it from his own point of view, Rose will look at it from her own point of view, Father will look at it from her own, Professor Prashant will look at it from his own point of view. So multiple readings are possible, and as a result of which there is semantic richness, semantic polysemy, not just one meaning but many meanings, multiple meanings, a plurality of meanings. So don't you think this is rich? All this will happen only when the author shuts his or her mouth, only when the author is declared dead. So three concepts, the death of the author. Number one, semantic autonomy. We need to liberate, free the text from the clutches of the author. And once the text is liberated from the author, the text is available, the text is open to multiple readings, multiple interpretations, as a result of which there is not one single meaning but many meanings, divergent meanings, semantic polysemy. And it also promotes the third idea and the last idea, the birth of the reader. You remember what is the last sentence of the death of the author? With the death of the author, we have the birth of the reader. Okay? I'm sure this is clear. Okay, fine. I said we have to answer one more question. What is that one more question? Is this an absolutely original idea? The answer is yes and no. Now, already in 1946, two Americans, one was a professor of English and the other was a professor of aesthetics, together, they wrote two essays in the domain of new criticism. Both the essays end with the word fallacy. Okay, intentional fallacy and affective fallacy. Fallacy is a word that is used in logic, particularly in philosophy, to refer to any specious argument or any wrong argument or any erroneous argument. Okay, so what is this intentional fallacy? Intentional fallacy is also known as genetic fallacy. In other words, it is useless to go after the author's intention when you analyze a poem. So that is intentional fallacy. If you want the exact line, this is the exact line taken from the essay Intentional Fallacy, written jointly by Wimsatt and Beardsley. Okay, one was a professor of English, the other was a professor of aesthetics. So both of them would tell us the intention is, I am quoting Wimsatt and Beardsley, neither available nor desirable. Look at the two words. Okay? To critique a poem, to criticize a poem, to analyze a poem, you don't require the intention of the author. Even if the intention of the author were to be available, you don't use it as a yardstick or a touchstone to measure the success of a poem. Okay? So I have already talked about three theories. Theory is multidisciplinary. Theory is no more the handmaiden of literature, and theory has announced the death of the author. I said I will talk about five. I will finish with four. Okay, so the last one, theory has announced the death of meta-narrative. Theory has announced the death of meta-narrative. How do you define postmodernism? Can I ask you? How do you define postmodernism? Anyone? I mean, of course, there are many definitions available. But Okay, okay, fine, fine. What is your name? You're a staff? Okay, okay, fine. Anyway, my hearty congratulations to you. So there are many definitions of postmodernism. One of the standard staple definitions of postmodernism is incredulity towards meta-narratives. Okay, incredulity meaning distrust, suspicion. If you want a very strong word, a strong alternative or a replacement, death. Okay, what is postmodernism? Death of meta-narrative, incredulity towards meta-narrative, distrust or suspicion towards meta-narratives. Okay, what is a meta-narrative? Meta-narrative is a grand narrative. It is a totalizing narrative. It is an overarching narrative. Okay, who came up with this definition? Okay, Jean-François Lyotard, Lyotard. Now what happened was, the Council of Universities in Quebec, Canada. In Canada, how many languages are spoken, Lakshmi? Okay, two languages. We have the French-speaking Canadian provinces and the English-speaking Canadian provinces. Now the French-speaking Canadian provinces, the Council of Universities in Quebec, in the late 1970s, they wanted to undertake an international survey, a global survey, in order to find out the status of knowledge in the advanced countries of the world. Okay, now it was a project. So the project has to be given to an investigator. So the principal investigator of this international or global project was a French political philosopher called Lyotard. Okay, if you do a project, after 6 months or after 2 years, after the expiry of the term, we are supposed to submit a report. Yes or no? Okay, so this man, he submitted a report that was in 1979, and the English translation appeared in 1984, and it was published by Manchester University Press with the title, The Postmodern Condition, a report on knowledge. Look at the subtitle, a report on knowledge, because I made it very clear that the primary objective of the project was to find out the status of knowledge in the advanced societies of the world. Okay, fine. So it is a slim book, 120 pages, please read it. The foreword was written by Frederick Jameson. Now the author himself has written an introduction for 3.5 pages. You go to the last paragraph, that is where you get the most famous definition of postmodernism. Postmodernism as incredulity towards meta-narrative. So this is from Lyotard. What is your name? Your name? Huh? Adira. What is the spelling of feminism? Please, all of you, please write feminism. I want to check the spelling. Lakshmi has finished. Adira, finished? Please show me the spelling. Okay, how many of you have used a capital F and how many of you have used a small F? How many of you have added an S at the end? Okay, fine. Now, if you were to argue that there is one feminism, one land, one feminism for the entire world, whether it is an African nation or an Australian state or an Indian state or a Canadian state, there is only one feminism for the entire world, that is a meta-narrative, that is a grand narrative, that is a totalizing narrative. On the other hand, if you argue, no, there is no one single feminism for the entire world, depending on the local context, the cultural, economic, social context, we have a variety of feminisms, plural. That would be a mini narrative. A mini narrative is also known as a little narrative or a provincial narrative. Okay? So if you were to say there is only one feminism, postmodernism is against that. There is no only one voice. Multiplicity of voices, plurality of voices, including dissent. I underline including dissent. That is the true spirit of postmodernism. No, you cannot dissent, you cannot argue totalitarianism. These days I am reading a lot about Anna Arendt. I'm sure you have heard of Anna Arendt, so you please read. Somehow it makes a lot of sense reading it in this context. Okay? She was a German Jew. She escaped from Germany, and then her life story is very interesting. She has written on the birth of totalitarianism, and her most famous concept is the banality of evil. So please read Anna Arendt. Okay, she talks about the birth of totalitarianism. Somehow it rings a bell. Okay, so this is my fifth point. Okay, so what are the, okay, 4 points. What are the 4 points? Theory is multidisciplinary. Theory is no more the servant or the handmaiden of literature. Third one, theory has announced the death of the author. Theory has announced the death of the meta-narrative. I will take 5 more minutes and I will talk about one more because I promised to talk of 5. Theory wants to rewrite the canon. Theory wants to rewrite the canon. Maybe I can take 5 more minutes? Okay, fine. Theory rewrites the canon. I have already asked this father one question. Maybe I can ask that father. What's your name, father? Joseph. Okay, so shall we ask a very difficult question to that father? Yes. Okay, it's a very simple question. Father, how many books in the Bible? How many books in the Bible? How many books in the New Testament and how many books in the Old Testament, and together how many? Okay, so all of you agree? See, the Bible, this is the Sacred Heart College. So the Bible is divided into the Old Testament and the New Testament. The New Testament, how many books? Okay, Father says it has to be correct. 27 books. Yes, Father? 27. New Testament. Old Testament? Father is not very sure. Father says 46. Anyone says 39? Anyone says 39? Father, if I say 39, am I right or wrong? So the two priests, is it 46 or 39? Not 46. Okay, the word canon, okay. The word, I am not a Bible scholar, I am not a theologian either. Okay, so the word canon, C-A-N-O-N, it comes from Bible studies. Okay? Please listen, I'll just finish in 5 minutes. The word canon, spelling C-A-N-O-N, not the cannons used by the army. Okay, the word canon comes from Bible studies. Okay, I mean, priests will know, we have an excellent book called the Jerome Biblical Commentary. If you go to the Jerome Biblical Commentary, there is an entire chapter on canon. What is the meaning of canon? What is the origin of the word canon? What is the etymology of the word canon? And what is canon with reference to the Bible? So if you go to the origin of the word, the etymology of the word canon means reed, R-E-E-D. Later it became a measuring rod. In other words, what is acceptable and what is not acceptable. Now the Bible is divided into two. The Old Testament and the New Testament. The New Testament, it starts with the 4 Gospels and ends with Apocalypse or Revelation. There are 27 books and we don't have any quarrels. But how many Gospels are there, Father? Are you sure? Who is the saint who came to Kerala? Saint Thomas, yes? You know, he has written a Gospel? He has written a Gospel, but the church has not accepted it. Why? It is called non-canonical. So the word canon comes from Bible studies. Now the New Testament has only 27 books, but the Old Testament there is a controversy. There are two versions. We have the Protestant version and we have the Catholic version. Okay? I'm sure there are Protestants here, there are Catholics here. If you look at the Protestant Bible, this college is run by the Catholics. The Catholic Bible has 46 books. The Protestant Bible, any Protestant here? Okay, so the Protestant Bible has only 39 books, which means 7 books accepted by the Catholics as canonical are considered non-canonical or apocryphal. Okay, Judith, Esther, Maccabees. Okay, 7 books. Okay, anyway, let us not go into that Bible part of it because we are not biblical scholars or theologians, but I want you to know that the word canon comes from biblical studies. Okay, so what is canonical means what is acceptable. What is non-canonical is called apocryphal, meaning non-acceptable. Okay, fine. Now I'll give a short exercise. Please write 3 world's best authors. It could be a novelist or a poet or a playwright or a short story writer. Now, all of you, every one of you, 3 world's best authors. Now, I give you 30 seconds. Please write down the names of 3 world's best authors. It could be a poet, it could be a novelist, it could be a short story writer, it could be a dramatist. 3 world's best authors. Quick, 30 seconds. Thomas, you're not writing. Okay, fine, stop. Please stop writing. Maybe some 2 from this side and 2 from this side can read out their list. 2 volunteers from this side. Just to read out your list. Okay. Anybody can read out from this side? Okay, you please read out. What do you have written? Okay, Shakespeare. Please listen. Shakespeare, Milton, Thomas Hardy. Shakespeare? Gabriel Garcia Marquez. Arundhati Roy. Okay, now look at the list. Okay, just look into your own list and find out how many women are there. Find out. You are a woman, but you have not included any woman author. How many non-white authors are there in your list? Please check. Please check. 2 questions. How many women and how many non-white? So the canon, okay, please listen, I will stop. The canon is, normally we use 4 terms to talk about the canon, the literary canon today. Literary canon means a list of great writers and a list of great books. That is the meaning of canon today. Okay, don't worry about the Bible part of it. Literary canon means a list of great writers and the great books. Okay, today to describe the canon, we use 4 terms. Number 1, the canon is androcentric. All great writers happen to be men. This is not an accident, this is a question of politics. All great writers happen to be men. Number 2, the canon is Eurocentric. All great writers happen to be white. Once again, this is not an accident, but a politics. All great writers are bourgeois. Okay, very few from the marginalized communities. Even if somebody writes, a Dalit writer or a tribal writer or an Adivasi writer or a native writer, the world does not recognize it that easily. So the canon is androcentric, Eurocentric, bourgeois and homophobic. If you are a lesbian, if you are a gay, if you are a queer, the world refuses to accept your writings. Okay, so these are the 4 words that are used to describe the literary canon today. So therefore, what should we do? We have to rewrite the canon. Okay? So dear friends, I have finished. Now there is one last question that needs to be understood. Okay? There are two famous books. One is by Terry Eagleton called The End of Theory. Then there is another book by Thomas Doherty that is also called The End of Theory. Okay, so what is the question? Are the days of theory over? Is my question clear? We have pronounced the death of the author. Okay, we have pronounced the death of man. We have pronounced the death of philosophy. Is it time to pronounce the death of theory? Are the days of theory over? So there is a lot of debate. Okay, so two important books that came out in 1980s. We are in 2020. So Terry Eagleton, I just want to read out one sentence from Terry Eagleton and with this I finish. So what is the question? The question is theory dead? Are the days of theory over? So Terry Eagleton writes in his book After Theory, which was published in 2003, just one sentence. He says, if theory means a reasonably systematic reflection on our guiding assumptions, theory remains as indispensable as ever. So what does he say? He uses the word indispensable, meaning theory will never die. Okay. So in the first part of the essay I talked about, in the first part of the lecture I talked about M.H. Abrams, his four coordinates and his four literary theories. And in the second part of this essay I talked about theory, modern literary, cultural, philosophical, anthropological, sociological, semiological theory, and I talked about the five characteristics of theory, and towards the end I raised a question, is theory dead? And I have also given you Eagleton's reply. Okay? So thank you very much.